It's time to begin our Bible class. We'd like to invite everybody to come in. Sometimes I think I'd do okay with a dog, but then every once in a while, Jeannie said, boy, if we had a kid, we'd let that kid have anything. She thinks I'm too permissive with a dog. Maybe I am, so I don't really, I'm nervous about trying to tell anybody else how to do their kids and to raise their kids. And I, yet I know scriptures on this, probably inside and out, a lot of them. I know some scriptures, like train up a child in the way he should go, and when he's old, he'll not depart from it. And I know that a lot of you know that scripture, and a lot of you have tried your best to follow that scripture, but something happens along the way. A child grows independent and goes their own way. And when it comes to divorce, I was thinking about how much this has affected all of us as a church, as a nation. I mean, the statistics on this continue to just pile up. And now we're not even getting a full picture of statistics because many are choosing to live together and then not get married, so we don't have a divorce stat on anything like that. I was thinking about this, nervous about it, but I was just envisioning in my mind our church directory, or in particular, just thinking about a Sunday morning assembly. And I don't want you to dwell on this morning to where you're sitting down with your notepad and taking notes. But there's not very many families in our congregation who have not been impacted by divorce. I mean, you can look at every row and just about see somebody maybe immediately impacted. The family tree, maybe the immediate widows are impacted. And then if you look a little more carefully, you say, boy, they've gone unscathed. They don't have any divorce issues in there. Go back a tree or two. Widen the circle just a little bit. And then, and I don't mean this to be depressing, but the verdict's still out on a lot. So it has really impacted everybody. So I guess we could take a couple different approaches to this. We could say, well, don't bring it up. It's painful. Let's not even talk about it. That's not a good answer, is it? That's kind of like sticking your head in the sand. So we need to talk about it. Maybe, and I don't want to be too hard on those of us who preach and those who are elders and deacons and leaders in the church, but, you know, we might make a strong statement and say the reason we're in this mess today is because we didn't preach strong enough. Some of you may feel it. Maybe that's an effort to push the blame somewhere else, I don't know. It's really not the preacher's job to raise our households. Some would like to think the blame can be placed on preachers and elders for not overseeing everything, but it's the dad and mom's responsibility. First and foremost, we need to be a help in any way we can. So when I bring all this up, I don't mean to be a bummer. So let's start here this morning, and I wish I could have these prefatory comments somewhere etched in stone to where they could precede every episode in this series, because I'm talking to you sincerely here. I really, my intention is not to be painful, and my intention is certainly not to be a know-it-all. I think there's room for lots of humility on the part of all of us when it comes to this. So we're going to bring up a whole bunch of different issues about family building. Somewhere along the line, we're probably even going to talk about spank or no spank. Nick, would you go ahead and do some research on that? So there are a lot of controversial issues that we might talk about, and none of us has the answer to all these, but there is not a perfect parent among us. Some good ones. But nobody's done it with perfection. And husbands and wives, some of you are really good ones. Sometimes I think I'm okay, and then, boy, I get a memo that I'm not doing as good as I thought I was. So we all have work to do. Well, let's start out about talking today about the sanctity of marriage. And what I started to tell you before, when you decide on a topic like this, your mind races, saying, what are we going to talk about? There are so many things we can talk about. So in my case, I just get out my sketch pad and I start writing down different side topics. And then I begin to think about the different individual topics and some of the resources that I have or maybe I'll need in talking about this. Like one subject that we'll talk about, maybe touch on today, just touch on it, is the concept of better communication within a marriage that really can make a big difference. And so what I'm trying to say is I'm thinking about kind of an all-star lineup, and I don't want to put too much pressure on myself or the whole class at the beginning, but I'm trying to think about some of the best things I've read on select subjects. So I say that to say this is not original. For example, again, on that one that we touched on, there's a really good book out, Men Are From Mars, Women Are From Venus. And that has to do with the way we communicate or don't communicate. So we'll share a little bit of that. This morning I want to share a little bit from an excerpt from Stephen Stanley. This is not the Charles Stanley that you encounter on television, but this is a Dr. Stephen Stanley, and he's written a book called The Heart of Commitment. Now let me read just two pages from this, and again, this kind of gives us the direction that we want to go as we talk again about. I ask you, what does it mean if we say the sanctity of marriage? Can anybody help us with this? We hear this expression, but what does it mean? What does the sanctity of marriage mean?
Marriage is set apart by God as an institution.
Marriage is set apart by God. That Vic's getting at the root of this word sanctify. That's what it means to set apart. Now, here we are, a conservative church gathering on a Sunday morning, and we're talking about this, and Vic can say that, and we all nod our heads. Not everybody sees this as an essential. A lot of people don't even feel the need to bring marriage into the realm of the church. It's not something they need to ask God's approval of or God's blessing of or even be grateful to God for. It's just something they choose to do or not do. So we can say that marriage is sacred, but not everybody would see it that way. Unfortunately, probably if we said that 50 years ago, somebody would say, what do you mean not everybody says that? Everybody knows marriage is sacred. Our world's changing, in case you haven't noticed. And things that we used to hold very clearly in our minds are being tested. It used to be a given, and I'm not venturing down this road in this particular series. It used to be a given that when you talked about marriage, you were talking about heterosexual. A man and a woman and a man, not same-sex. If we brought up same-sex marriage 50 years ago, some of our grandmas would have had heart attacks. So let me read this little section here, and what I'm driving at in this little gem from this particular chapter is if we believe in the sanctity of marriage, that God has blessed it, not only did he ordain it, he created it for our good. This is the Genesis verses that you can read in the darkened portion at the top of your notes there. God created man. He saw that it was not good for Adam to dwell alone, so he created Eve to be a helpmeet, is the old King James. We kind of try to soften that today because it sounds chauvinistic. So we say a partner, and that's not a bad translation of a helpmeet. It wasn't that God created Eve to wait on Adam and Eve hand and feet, to wait on Adam. It was to be a partner, so that word is truly accepted. So we know, we can say that marriage is God's doing, and that therefore it's sacred. Sometimes we'll hear the words holy matrimony, and that again speaks to the sanctity of marriage. There's something very unique about this. I can I can choose to join the Exchange Club or the Lions Club or some other club out there and maybe enjoy it and do a good job and take part and make friends and all that. And then I can say, well, I'm tired of the Exchange Club, but this happened with me, and I don't want to be a part of it anymore. Not because I'm opposed to them, I'm lost interest there. There's nothing sacred about the Exchange Club. God didn't make it. It's not holy. It's not sanctified. So there's no big deal. I can be a part of this Exchange Club. I don't have to be a part of it, and I don't need to feel guilty if I'm not. But with marriage, we can't treat marriage like we do a lot of other things. Dick can want to play golf with his buddies, and then he can make up his mind, or Deb can make it up for him and say, you're not going to play anymore. Just tell him you don't want to be a part of the membership. And Vic can't say, oh, no, this is a sanctified, for the sanctity of golf. He's not going to talk that language. We get it. So we understand there's something very, very unique about marriage. Brings it up to a realm that's unlike others. I'm not saying unlike any others, but it's certainly not the ordinary. So what we then need to talk about is how do we respect the sanctity of marriage? And if we're trying to build really strong households, it seems to me like the real foundation is the husband and wife, even before the kids come along. So if you want to keep marriage strong, you've got to keep husband and wife strong. So there's a section in this book called Stuck, Sticking, or Stopped. And Stephen Stanley then presents us with a couple different options. He says some people end up getting stuck in marriage. It's kind of like, when I have a statement down here at the bottom of your notes, I think it is, about four or five lines up. How sad it would be to go through marriage led by this thought, you've made your choice, now live. Is that the way we want to go to our grave with our mate? Well, I made the choice years ago, so I have to live with it. That's not exactly the gusto or the zest that we want to take to our grave as we try to have a good marriage. So what we want to talk about is not getting married and then later being stuck, and not what we want to learn to do is stick, but not just stick. We want to enjoy sticking. We don't want to get to a point later on, well, I'm not happy here, but I guess I'll stay with it. We want it to be sweeter as the years go by. So let me read this chapter, and then we'll segue to some questions and answers. Here in the United States, the big day had finally arrived. It was a carefully planned wedding, and all the plans were going smoothly, except that Lisa didn't feel so smooth inside. As her mother helped her straighten her veil, Lisa whispered, "What if I'm not making the right choice?" Although she could have been expressing wedding day jitters, Lisa really did have doubts. She and Stephen had dated a long time, for 4 years. It seemed reasonable to go ahead and get married. She countered to herself, "I mean, who else has come along that I like as well?" Lisa's mother and father had divorced when Lisa was 7. She remembered the pain of their separation as if it were yesterday. That event and the years of preceding turmoil and conflict had left her truly skeptical about whether any marriage could really work, at least over many years. While Lisa was wondering whether she was doing the right thing, her mother tried to comfort her. "Honey, you don't have to worry so much. Remember, you can always come back if things don't work out with you and Steve." To her mother's surprise, Lisa burst into sad and anxious sobs. Lisa really didn't want to hear that there was a lifeboat. There's something instructional in this, even though it might be painful to us. She wanted to hear that it was possible to have a lifelong happy marriage with Stephen. She had great doubts, but she wanted the doubts to go away. Lisa said to her mother through her tears, "Mom, thank you for trying to reassure me, but I desperately want to know that it's really possible for this to work. This is not a fairy tale. I am so afraid that we don't have what it takes, but I want to make it last all my life. That just doesn't seem realistic, does it?" "Well, does it? What do you think?" This is Stanley asking us. Her mother went on to answer her with the reassurances that Lisa was hoping for. Mom told her that things could be different for her and Stephen. She didn't need to end up unhappy in her marriage. She didn't have to end up divorced. Lisa managed to smile, but still she recognized inside and out. Do we know how to live out a commitment over many years? Again, Dr. Stanley asking us. Just with Lisa struggling, do we have the mental thoughts and the perseverance to make a commitment and then say, this is gonna work? Now, I know that may sound braggadocio, and some have made that bluster and ended up their marriage has crashed and burned. She entered her marriage on that day with all her desires and doubts. She was worried that they would end up stuck, but not sticking. Lisa desperately hoped that she and Stephen would remain faithful in their dedication to each other for the rest of their lives, but she knew that they could end up just stuck together for decades. Okay, one more and a little briefer. On the same day, Jeremy and Suzanne were getting married across town. It was a day of anticipation and rejoicing for both families. Jeremy's best man was his brother Chris, who had gotten married only 2 months earlier. Suzanne was with her mother, her sister, and Jeremy's mother getting ready in another part of the church. While Jeremy's father and brother were in the room chatting with him, he closed the door and said, "I have something I want to say that I want you both to hear." Jeremy stood before his father and his brother and said, "The commitment that I'm making today is sacred. I am committing myself to Suzanne for life, for all that I am and can be in this marriage. From this day forward, I remove the word divorce from my vocabulary. I am asking both of you to hold me accountable to this commitment. I am asking you to push me to love her in the fullest measure for all of my life. I could read the rest of it, but they were not planning on being stuck. This couple was planning on sticking. Okay, we could cherry pick stories like that one after another. We've all seen them. That's not makeup stuff. We know some of those things have been acted out right before our very eyes. So if we're going to start out saying that there is a sanctity of marriage, and I think it's biblical to read it that way, I mean, we could, I don't have time here this morning, but we're not trying to say that marriage is for everybody. Some of us have friends who have chosen to be celibate. Or maybe they're celibate because they have not yet met the right person. And they're living a good and godly life and happy to be alive and respectful of God and the church and the Word. Jesus, we don't have any record that he was ever married, contrary to what you might read on some special or hear on some special TV program. The Apostle Paul, he definitely lived a celibate life. Some argue that he was a member of the Sanhedrin and therefore he had to be married, but Paul makes a statement, do I not have a right to carry a level life, as does Peter and the rest of the apostles? So you can live a good life. Paul makes some statements that are somewhat, I'd really like to go down this road sometime later, but there are, in Paul's letter to the Corinthians, he basically says, in view of the present distress, I recommend you not get married. If you're not married, don't get married. And you have to ask, what's up with that? Well, when you understand, part of this is what we were talking about in this period of time known as the last days of Judaism. The world was being turned upside down. And persecution was intense, and tribulations and turmoil. And it's a lot easier to go on the run than to go on the run with a wife and children. So Paul is simply saying there, it's better under these circumstances that you not marry. But then he adds the statement, it's better to marry than to murder. And that's been a verse that's been brought a lot of discussion. What did Paul mean when he said it's better to marry than to burn? Is he talking about burning in hell because you ended up living an immoral life? Or is he talking about burning with passion? If you can't respect celibacy, if you can't handle celibacy, then you find a mate and marry because you don't want to spend your life. Okay, so that's one aspect of it. But what I want to talk about is how have we come to devalue marriage? Is this just a talking point for the church? I'm wanting comments from you guys now. Vic?
As society takes away the sanctity of marriage as God ordained, which puts it in a special place, if you have that attitude that it is that, then you're going to consider a lot of things before you get married. But if you think it's just like joining the club and leaving the club that you're talking about, that it's not God sanctified, it has no ramifications that way, then it's no big deal. They don't look at it as anything other than just joining together for a while and leaving. They don't see any negative ramifications. They don't see the responsibility that's required before. It's kind of like, well, the church is God's, is the bride of Jesus. So if you lose your concept or God sanctifying marriage, he also sanctified the church in the same way, with us being the bride of Christ. And maybe that's why a lot of people just don't believe the church and don't even think twice about it. They don't think things just as flippantly as that as they do a marriage.
Good observation or comment, Vic. So sometimes we're flippant, and that just means we don't take the whole thing as serious as we ought to. Now, I have to say, you know, I've been in preaching now and ministerial work for over 40 years, and I've done quite a few weddings along the way, and for a number of them, I've done what we might call premarital counseling, and I don't really remember too many that went into that day, the day of their marriage, with a kind of lackadaisical, blasé, flippant attitude. I do remember over all the counseling that I've done, I remember one case where the husband-to-be wanted nothing to do with premarital counseling. Nothing whatsoever to do with it. And for right or wrong, I ended up telling the bride-to-be, I said, I don't really want to do your wedding because I don't think it's going to last very long at all. Oh, she got mad. And I got some flack from some of the family about it. And she ended up going to Florida to rendezvous with him. And they got married, justice of the peace or something, and 3 weeks later, marriage was over. Never reunited. Well, that's not, I mean, any of you could have seen that train wreck coming. When somebody has no interest whatsoever, I'm not saying you have to sign up for a 6 weeks premarital counseling course, but when you get the impression that this person doesn't want to, they don't want to know anything about how to make the marriage last because they really don't intend. Why waste your energy in trying to think about how all the ways we can make this marriage last? That's not your goal. You're not worried about that. Comments or questions?
Terry, as one of the few people sitting in the room who has been married in court, who is married for a long time, I like to tell people that Mark and I were married for 33 years, and at least 30 of them were happy. Anybody who's been married gets a chuckle out of that. And now, of course, I'm not married. But one of the things that we need to remember is we have not created anything new. What's going on today went on 2,000 years ago. In the Jewish religion, men can get rid of their wives for any reason whatsoever. The same thing in the Roman Empire. There was no sanctity in marriage. When Jesus starts preaching to them about this, you know, I'm sure the men, their heads were coming off. What do you mean we can't do this, that, and the other? Of course we can.
What you're saying there, when you said there was no sanctity, you're not saying that God didn't intend to sanctify it. It's that they came to disrespect it and disvalue it.
Men had come to say, just like the man you were counseling, we're going to do what we want to do, when we want to do it, and we're going to make it okay by law.
Yeah, even the leaders in the church came to, but you know, it is interesting when Jesus, and I have this in your notes, that when Jesus reiterates the Genesis story, what he adds the statement, what God has joined together, let no man separate. That's not found in the original text, in the words of, you know, God creates Eve from Adam's rib and brings them together, and he says, for this cause shall a man leave his father and mother and shall cling or cleave to his wife. Jesus quotes that, but then he adds, what God has joined together, let not man put asunder.
So when you look at it,
I'm sorry, did I interrupt you?
It's okay. I think we have to appreciate what the real problem is. The real problem with the man who didn't want to do counseling with you was not that he didn't want to do counseling or that he didn't think that there was sanctity in marriage. He thought he was God. He had put himself in the wrong position. I have a poster in Joan Joan's room, and it's now in Nicholas's room. The 21 rules for a happy life, and I tell the lads kids this all the time. Number one rule, be careful who you marry, because they will determine 90% of your happiness or your unhappiness in life. And I tell the kids all the time, love is a terrible reason to get married, because love comes and goes. There better be something in that relationship, in that bond, that's going to sustain you when things get rough, because things are going to get rough. And you better have the right foundation, and you better be marrying somebody who understands that God is God and we're not. Most of what happens, at least in my circle, and what I see with my friends, is that people want to, they want to be God. They don't want to follow the rules. I have two friends of mine right now who are getting divorced, and it's upset me more than, and maybe it's because Mark just died and they're our age, and I just want to slap the husband. But I haven't, so I get a brownie for it. But he wants to do exactly what he wants to do now. He thinks for some reason that he's entitled to it. And this is a person who would tell you to your face that he's a God-loving, believing Christian. And I just throw my hands up.
Good comments, Jay. Trudy?
Well, most of the people in this room have been married for quite a while. We didn't go in with blinders on. You go in thinking, okay, we're going to make this work. Because my mom and dad, they were married almost 30 years before they got a divorce, but they didn't live together. And my dad, before we got married, he says, now you made your bed, you lied. And I always thought, there's no way I'm going to move back home with that type of attitude. Maybe we've made it a little too easy to get divorces or people living together and having children out of wedlock. You know, I always tell the kids, you finish high school, you finish college, you get married, then kids, in that order. Now, it doesn't always work out that way. But maybe we've made it too easy. We've left the door open. Well, yeah, you can come home and bring your kids and things like that.
Yeah, and Trudy, that, I think you're right, but boy, that's a hard predicament to be in. Just ask somebody that is going through that with their loved ones. You can't very well say, you got divorced, don't even call me. I mean, I guess you could take that approach. But what mom and dad is going to do that? You feel an obligation to help your child, boy or girl, to rebuild. I mean, there's nothing more devastating than divorce. So it's one thing, and I think your point is, let's not be casual about this. Let's have those conversations, and maybe let's think about this little story here where Lisa did not want to hear her mom say, if it doesn't work out, you can always come. Probably deep down, she's thankful that her parents have a good attitude that way, but she needed to hear evidently something else to assure her that she knew she's in this for serious and for the long haul.
Jane's dad never married anyone. He says, because it doesn't work out, I don't want to be blamed for it. He would counsel her. Yeah, he didn't want it on his conscience. I mean, he wouldn't marry Shannon and I or Judy.
We're out of town. Time. I want to protract this another week. So I want you to take these notes home and look at them a little bit more carefully. And where I'm not also flat-footed, and come back and let's talk a little bit more about this. And I may add to our study guide by, I want us to segue into this communication between husband and wife. We're going to start with the husband and wife, and then we're going to build. And eventually the kids are going to come on board, and with that, then there'll be other relationships that we need to talk about child rearing and stuff like that. Anybody have a suggestion? I don't know why I'm nervous about this. If there's something in particular that you want us to talk about in the course of this series, write it down and follow it. I do have the right to decline. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.